evening, good afternoon, wherever you are across the globe. Welcome to On the Sofa with yours truly, Esther Austin. But also on the sofa with me today, I barely slept. I've got CeCe Peniston. The CeCe Peniston is an absolute pleasure, CeCe.
Thank you. It's my pleasure to be here. Finally.
Back in
London. My pleasure always. I love it here. Look, I'm always teasing everybody with the British accent.
I absolutely love
the British accent, for real.
Because I remember the last time I interviewed you, we had this sort of back and forth with, you know, the British accent.
Yeah.
And you had little, was it Poochie or Poochini at the time? Your little dog?
I have another one.
You got another one?
I had Gucci and I have Gigi.
That's right. I remember the last time I interviewed CeCe, we had such great laughter about this little dog that looked like a rat, but you know, he's like...
And still another one like a rat.
But CeCe, you know, what are you bringing to the UK this time around? You're performing at Kisstory tomorrow. So what does CeCe Peniston bring to her audience in the UK?
I just feel like I'm full of life. I enjoy the audience. I bring the audience into what I'm doing. Don't be surprised if you're on stage. I'm just saying, I have a DJ, brand new music, just fashion. I love to dress. So yes. I like whatever's in current fashion. I try to do that. Nice. I love that. So.
Fantastic. And you know, CeCe, you've been in the game, in the industry for a very long time now. And, you know, people obviously know a lot of your story, your favourite tracks. Mm-hmm. But, you know, what is it that gets CeCe Peniston up every morning doing what she obviously loves to do?
Just knowing that I'm blessed. Even through all, like, the crazy stuff that people just don't know that happens in the background. Mm-hmm. But knowing that regardless of those things that I'm blessed and I'm still doing what I love to do after 30 years is such a blessing to me because... When I was little, I was around probably 11 years old, I said, I'm going to be a star one day. I used to run up and down the street in these little white boots, and my sister and them said I would come to them, and they said, thank you, white shoes now. I said, I'm going to have my name in lights, like that. I was 11, so just doing what I love.
Excellent. And there's this whole thing of visualization and knowing how to manifest, you know, your dreams, and you definitely are one that's brought that into motion. And so, you know, when you're up on stage, CeCe, where do you go? What does it do to you? You know, you're in the midst of sometimes hundreds and thousands of people. Where does CeCe go?
I mean, it just depends on my day. Sometimes you have a really, really good day. Mm-hmm. So sometimes you have a really, really bad day, but they don't know it because they come to your show and they're like, no, take me away from my bad day. You're like, well, I had a bad day too. So what you do is you look at the smiles and the laughter and the people that are singing your music and you go, you know what? My bad day just became beautiful. Mm-hmm. And so it's just so many things I look at. You know, people who come up to me and have said, you know what, you've created memories for me, or I came out to your song. If they're with the LGBT community, I came out to your song. So just, you know, smiles and laughter after.
Mm-hmm. And if I may just touch briefly, and you lost your mother last year, how did that affect you in terms of an artist and having to go out on stage and face the world, CeCe?
Meeting with my mother was very, very hard for me. It was like I was very, very brokenhearted about it. It's funny because I was home for a month. She was there with me. Me and my brothers and sisters, we would take turns watching her and preparing her meals and taking care of her. And I remember I was there for the month and I said, Mommy, I'm getting ready to leave. I said, I'll be right back tomorrow. Be right back. And she said, oh, that's right, baby. I said, okay, I love you. She said, I love you too. And I left. And she passed. And it was crazy because I had to be on BBC TV for, and even for Carl Cox. And I could just, I felt it. I was in the room. And I said, yes. I said, prepare yourself. I said, oh my God. 10 minutes later, they had called me and told me she had passed. It's like I felt her soul leave. But what I can tell you is that my mother is up in heaven with her rhinestone angel wings, and I swear she has been like, first order of business is to take care of my child. And excellent. So she has been guiding me.
Yes. You, can feel her. She's definitely around you all the time. And you know, your mother, she was obviously very pivotal in your life, but you're also very close. Because I remember the last time I interviewed you, you spoke about the times when you used to have your girly trips
out
and how important those were. And so how do you feel personally for women out there who are trying to form that bond with their child? What is the importance of that?
You know, I feel like your mother or your father are the first people that you learn to love in this life. And if you don't learn to love your mother or learn to love your father, it's very hard for you to have a relationship with a man if you're a woman and you don't really love your father. If you don't love your mother, it's very hard for a man to have a relationship with a woman, because you don't see that romance or you don't see that love, and you know that makes it very difficult for somebody to say, I don't trust. Mm-hmm. And it's not because they don't want to or want to love, but it's just you haven't seen it or felt it or those kind of things. So you know, it's funny because also when she passed, I had to get on stage like 3 days later. And I can remember just feeling so frustrated. I had one of those weird crowds and I was like, stop the music, DJ. And he was looking at me. I said, no, stop. Mm-hmm. I said, are you guys here to have a good time? They were just giving me a hard time. And it's like, I knew they were from my era. Mm-hmm. And I was like, what is this? And when I said, do you guys know how hard it is to perform? You know, when you've lost your mother after 3 days, you understand I'm here, I'm with you. And after that, they seem to be like, oh, she had a human moment, and they related to me differently. And I think that that's what music is. I feel like people want to feel like they can touch you and feel you and that you relate to them on some type of level. So,
and I guess the next question then, you know, where do you go in those moments when you are feeling maybe a bit low or maybe not really feeling and wanting to go there? Where do you go? What do you do to sort of help to pacify or just get some nurturing and love to CeCe?
I hide. You know how you hear sometimes about artists being hermits? I actually do. There have been times where I have stayed in the house a week and I have just said, you need to grow in this moment, writing your journal. Look at your vision board that you created. As me being a visionary, I put my vision boards in front of me and I say, get away from that. Be you. Mm-hmm. It's funny because Janet, she's in the room, you guys can't see her, but I'll call her, we'll talk. I'll be in no makeup, a headscarf. I love to cook. That's my getaway as well. I write in my journal. I just say, okay, where are we going next? And then people don't know that because every time they see me, I'm dressed. So they're like, oh, she's probably always like that, or she's on, or she's bougie. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, you just don't know. You just don't know what people have on their heart or what they go through, because we show you what you're supposed to see. That's as an artist. Is this.
Yes. Yeah. And was there ever a point, CeCe, that you struggled between those two parts of yourself, you know, the natural, this is who I am, to the part that you show to the world? Was there ever that sort of dichotomy of, actually, I don't feel like going out there like this today, but I know I have to?
Oh, many times, even when it was a great show, and I'm like, I've been on the road for 3 months, and it's like, oh my God, I gotta put makeup on, I'm so tired. I don't feel like it. I can't sing today, my voice is hoarse. Mm. I deal with allergies a lot, so sometimes I'm going to different places. And I've learned how to manage it now. I get allergy shots and different stuff, but I know my voice is worse. And I'm like, oh, you have to sing. And I'm like, now that I sound like Johnny Gill, okay, now I got to get on stage and I got to sing. Or I can remember coming to my mom at the time. I said, Mommy, I'm tired of this. Mm-hmm. And she said, why? I said, because there's not a lot of good people in the music business. I said, they don't mean you well. They don't treat you correctly. There's so much competition and behind the scenes politics that people do, and I know that I'm good-hearted and I give to people. And I said, I'm so tired of giving. She said, I don't know how to do this. She said, but I will learn and I will give you whatever you need. She said, but I'm not allowing you to quit. And I said, well, if you're gonna do all that, then I can now. And I said, I guess I was just having a human moment of being emotional or being whatever, because I love the singing part. I just don't like what happens on stage. She says, let me handle that and you get on stage. And that's how it happened.
Okay, CeCe, so thank you very much for sharing about the experience with your mother. It's very poignant, but also I love your down-to-earthness and your down-to-earthiness. And what I'd like to ask now, CeCe, have there been any other moments in your life where you felt challenged, where you felt, you know, that I don't want to face the world, but you had to face the world? I know when we spoke the last time, you mentioned something around what you went through in terms of not having a child and all the emotions around that. Right. So can you just share a bit about that process for you?
For me, that was a very, very hard moment because, you know, there's times when it's like I was pregnant and the baby didn't happen. And it was like, wow. They don't know that I just came off of being pregnant like 2 weeks ago and I'm still grieving and feeling like, you know, my ego is bruised just as a woman and as a wife, and I was married at the time. And so it's like, there's just sadness there. And I'm singing all these happy songs to everyone else. And I'm like, in my heart, I'm like, God, I wanted a baby. I wanted to feel that motherhood. And so I said, you know, I said, after certain times of going through that, I said to myself, well, God must have another mission for me. I said that I'm not having children. I said, so maybe it's to help somebody else who didn't have a child and let them know that there is some type of comfort from someone who is all over the world and who's seen as this entertainer, and for them to know that, hey, I've been through that, I understand.
Mm-hmm. And when you see your friends or other people with kids, does it still have that sort of moment for you?
You know what? Not anymore. I've understood how to work through it. In fact, it's funny that you asked, because there's a new baby in the family. And it's kind of funny, when my mom got sick, I got nervous because I was like, my brother found out we were having a baby. And I said, usually God takes one life to give another.
That's right.
And so we knew in our hearts, but we didn't really talk about it much because we knew we'd cry about it. Mm-hmm. So we said, God must be taking mommy to give us her. And so she's been around and she's been such a joy. Her name is Alina. Mm-hmm. And I post her on our Instagram sometime, and she has little tool skirts like her auntie. And they had one of her playing little notes on the keyboard with her feet. And I said, oh, she's remixing finally already. People just started laughing and they thought that was so funny. But I know that now that, you know what, I get to live through other people. I was an ambassador for the PTA. And I remember this one lady came up to me and she said, you don't have any kids. Why are you an ambassador? And I said, don't you want to pick that up? She said, what? I said, your face.
Ooh.
And she was like, excuse me? I said, yes. Mm-hmm. I said, look. I said, I tried to have children, but I didn't. I said, but guess what? I said, the thing that you don't know is with the PTA, I have many children.
Excellent.
Who I can love and I can be a mentor to. I said, so you need to be mindful of how you speak to people because you don't know their journey.
Excellent. Mm-hmm. Okay, well, ladies and gentlemen, we're back with this rather interesting and poignant interview with the legendary CeCe Peniston, and she is more than just finally. And so what we're going to talk about now is this whole thing of stepping into your greatness, stepping into your truth, walking in your truth. And sometimes that means you walk alone, and you have to be prepared to walk on your own. And as you journey through life, you evolve and your experiences hone you to become who you are. And it's at that place where you own it.
Absolutely. Without judgment, without worrying about what other people think about you, you do what you do. And I feel like there's been lots of times where it's like, I'll dress a certain way or do a certain thing, and they're like, you're doing too much. And I'm like, well, am I doing too much for you?
Yes.
Or am I just doing too much?
Yes.
There's a difference. Why don't you bring yours up so that I can be me?
I gotta do a high five.
I'm serious. What did Nelson Mandela say? Don't bring down your greatness for somebody else. Have them bring themselves up, you know. And it's just, you know, I feel like we're in the entertainment world and people came to see the show. So why would you dress like the people in the audience?
Mm.
They want to see you do something else and different.
Different, that's right.
You know?
That's right. And it's interesting because as part of this conversation also, it's about when you step into your greatness and your truth, you're often ostracized or, as you said, judged because of that. But then there's a freedom in that, isn't there, CeCe?
It is, because you know what, I'm like, I'm going to be completely me. Mm-hmm. You may or may not like it, but I'm going to be myself. And I enjoy looking and saying, okay, how can I do that different?
Yes.
It's not me being competing, it's me saying, how can I make it CeCe? Because I feel like, you know what, I'm the type of woman where I like to empower other women, I like to empower friends, and anybody who knows me know that my heart is good and knows that I empower other people around me. Sometimes it's backfired on me, but that's okay.
Mm-hmm.
You know, sometimes you give someone the tools and they step in your place, but then you say, that's okay, I have 10 more things that I'm doing, don't worry about it. I'm moving on to those other 10 things that we didn't talk about, so it's okay. But it's just, it's the main thing that, in the realm of things, in the big picture of things, the biggest thing is the music.
Mm.
And the music isn't touching people, then you're not doing your job.
And is that also because it's not coming from a place, the place that it should be within you? Because when you focus on self, and when you actually know who you are, then you embody that essence into your music.
Absolutely, you have to come straight from the heart and soul. And it's funny because I recently did a studio session. Oh, girl, I was like, this feels like 1991, we got a love thing. Okay, and I'm gonna tell you why, because the song was probably 2 octaves above like what I normally sing, right? And the guy, he wasn't a singer. He was like the producer. He said, well, my producer did the song, and I said, does your producer know that this is like way up here and then it goes here instead of here and goes there? He goes, I'm not the singer. So he didn't understand. And the guy was like, okay, let me tell you what this is. He said, pretty much she's yelling through the whole song and she has to come from her gut. So I'm just letting you know now. But what it did for me was it said, after 30 years that you're still doing what you love to do and that you could do it. So I enjoyed the challenge of doing it and putting my heart and soul into it, because it wasn't an easy thing to do, but I love the result.
And you know, I've watched you perform, like I was saying, I was watching, looking through Instagram this week, and I saw you step out in these heels and you did this sort of step, and she stepped, and I'm like, I could just about imagine these. And you know, how do you hold the poise and move and, you know, how do you embody all of that within your performance?
You know what I think that I would say, that there is different sides of me that happen throughout me doing a stage show. You know how, like, okay, remember when Beyonce said Sasha Fierce comes out?
Yes.
I feel like there's another, I'm not Cecilia in that moment. I'm CeCe.
Yes.
And people often crack up because it's kind of like a character. I mean, it really is. It's like this character that comes up that gives you the inner being.
Who she really is.
You know, who she really is. The inner being that you probably don't show on a regular basis.
Yes.
But it's, you know, it's also a part of you as well.
Okay, so as I said before, I'm with the legendary CeCe Peniston. But she's very much a woman in her own right. And what I love about her, what you see is what you get. If you don't like it, then that's, you know, you just got to work through that yourselves. But then that's also when you learn to stand in your power. And this whole thing of standing in your power and standing in your truth is a journey. It's been a journey for all of us. But, you know, when you sort of arrive, and we're always arriving.
Right, always.
Okay, you're always arriving. But when you arrive in certain places, own it. And I believe this woman owns that place and owns her power. And also, she's not just an artist, she's a product of her experiences. And on some level, she recognizes that. And so she can choose what she does with those experiences in terms of who she is. You know, at any one moment in time, we have choices. They might not always be choices that we would like to take, But then when we take personal responsibility for our world, it can manifest anything and show up as this gorgeous woman is showing up as. And so CeCe, you know, you're here to perform at Kisstory tomorrow. What can the UK expect from you? I mean, and also, where are you going after this? Because you're in the London and you're doing a lot of traveling, but, you know, what else?
A lot of different things. I'm going to be having several shows coming up that are live. A good thing that I'm doing this year more is moving into live band. But first, we got Kisstory. So I got a great DJ, DJ Wakal. He's going to be here with me. Just great energy. And the thing I love about the UK audience is music never gets old here.
Yes.
The artists never get old. The music never gets old. So, you know, as an artist, you always feel loved here. So I can't wait to perform tomorrow for Kisstory. Kiss FM, giving a shout out to Kiss FM. So I can't wait. And what's next for me is I'm doing a lot of the wineries, live band, DC City Winery, LA, Atlanta City Winery, Chicago City Winery, House of Blues coming up, a corporate gig for the owner of all the Holiday Inns. Me and Danny and Adam Holly going to do a show together. And, you know, Mr. Olympia, I'll be there. I'll be at Sean, I'll be at his IBF Pro, Jay Hammett.
Can I come back in your handbag or something? I need to be amongst all of this.
I can take this
for but if I have to.
Thank you. You know, the thing that people don't know about me is that in my 45th birthday, I did a NPC bodybuilding competition. And I'll send you those pictures. You saw that, right?
I saw that.
So I'm getting back into my bodybuilding stuff. This time I won't be competing at Mr. Olympia, but I'll be showing up there.
Excellent.
And so just, you know, doing more fitness, doing more healthy eating, and more live band.
I think I'm going to go home and do some more planking.
Girl, me too, girl. After I pull my damn bag.
Look, it's the heels.
Girl. And then skincare. Working on some skincare, some merch, stuff like that.
Okay, wow. I'm definitely just trying to find my way into your suitcase.
Girl, come on, girl, let's go. Look.
And I'm writing down CeCe because I guess I haven't really asked you much about your music because we know about your music. Mm-hmm. And I really wanted to understand about CeCe the person because who you are, I believe, feeds into the music. Is that making sense?
I understand.
And in moving forward in terms of musically, what's on the cards in terms of new stuff?
Well, I just did a project for Sony, actually, two songs for Sony that's going to be coming out. One is a compilation. I can't tell you with who yet, but it's coming.
That's okay. I can wait.
It's coming. It's really good. And then I'm also doing my working on a publishing deal, and some other music that I'm doing. So just keep your eyes and ears open. I had done a song for 480 East, which I'll be singing tomorrow. It's called "Are You Ready," which is out right now on Spotify and all the streaming sites. It's called "Are You Ready."
So I'm ready to come in your suitcase soon.
Yeah, girl,
soon.
Let's go.
You know, how much more hinting can I do?
Oh, so it was me. So it was me, Danny Lerman, and Adam Holly, and then Janet. What was the other guy with the drum? What's his name?
Dabuka player.
Dabuka. Is that what's his name?
Yes, the name is Daud.
Daud.
And the instrument is Dabuka, and he's the best from Indonesia. He's from Texas, and he lived for 22 years in Jakarta.
I'll show you that clip. He plays a live drum and it lights up. So it's like, and I'm also going to Bali. I'm shows near you. I'll be going to Bali coming up for a show there to be playing with him. So
excellent. So for anyone who wants to follow a dream and now sit on the sidelines, maybe think about all the impossibilities around it, what's that one piece of advice that CeCe Peniston can offer to them to say, just do it, as like you said?
You know what? If you fall, always fall on your back, because then you're always looking forward. And you can get right on up and keep going. Have vision. Understand that even through the tears, even through the sadness, that God is always there. I do vision boards personally. So that's what I believe in. I watch the vision boards and I say, I don't watch anything else going on around me but that. And I've seen the value of that when you map and outline your whole life in advance, but it doesn't, you don't get off course.
Brilliant. Thank you. Well, CeCe, thank you so much for taking the time to meet me. It's been an absolute pleasure. And you know that I'm going to ask you to sing.
Oh my God.
It's got to be finally. I know, finally. But it's almost like finally we've gotten to meet, because I've interviewed CeCe about 3 times now. And, you know, she's here in the flesh. Look, I can touch her.
Say, okay. Finally, yeah.